up though is Dr. Candido, and those of you who missed his talk yesterday, it really leads into our SCS talks that Dr. Singh did. You know, we're seeing awesome outcomes, but the insurers are doing everything to limit this because we're using it more and more and it's a cost to them. Today, he is gonna talk to us about the dreaded C word. And I'm not talking about that, I'm talking about complications. But anyway, Dr. Candido, if anybody's done any training over in Chicago, he's been there, the kingpin there for 30 years, and he's probably touched every one of you who's been through Chicago. He shared some awesome stuff he's doing with regenerative medicine. And he was talking about his affiliation with all these sports stars. And really, what he is best known for is not his, you know, New York personality or his awesome results that he gets on his skills for his patients in Chicago, but he has this world record setting feat that hardly anybody knows about.
I mean, he's nailing it! Yeah, the next one, all of us close will be off, I think. Nothing but net, nothing but death. Very good. Yeah, that is awesome. He had no idea I was going to do this to him.
Thank you for that interesting introduction, David. Yeah, one of my quirky behavioral things that I do to relieve stress is I don't play golf. David said, yeah, I'm out of Chicago. He says, anyone who's passed through there, I probably touched them, but I haven't touched them inappropriately, David. I want to emphasize that because we are at a public venue, of course. Interesting, with such great speakers here for neuromodulation, Dr. Caprell, Dr. Singh, we've got Dr. Epter here talking about neuromodulation, I'm always asked to do the complications talk. And I'm wondering whether my personal practice in Chicago, whether the side effects and things that I've done have infiltrated all the way down here to Georgia. So we'll talk a little bit today about the avoidable complications. And not everything that we do is avoidable, of course. There are things that happen, so-called acts of God, if you will. But there are certain things that we have available to us under our control. One thing that we're not doing very well with neuromodulation is we're not really preventing infection risks. Despite all the new things on the horizon, all the tremendous technology, all the new waveforms, all the new devices, we haven't yet been able to get a grasp on infectious complications. So I'm not going to belabor a lot of the points. I'm not going to talk extensively about things like paralysis and death. In fact, just to mention them in passing, those things obviously can occur. They're catastrophic when they do occur. The legal literature is replete with some of the things that have been known to occur with neuromodulation and intrathecal drug delivery systems. We're not going to talk extensively about post-dural puncture headache. I've written a scientific paper and published that a few years back with Captain Rom Stevens from the United States Navy. If you have an interest in dural puncture headache, I encourage you to read that paper. It's got about 190 references supporting it. I think it's the most comprehensive paper ever written on post-dural puncture headache. I've got no disclosures as they relate to this educational activity, and I'm hearkened to three sayings. One of them was the famous saying of Professor Alan Whitty. He had a sign on his desk in his office at the University of Illinois, and he said, "Those who forget the past are condemned to relive it or repeat it," which was attributed to George Santayana, but actually goes all the way back to ancient times. Confucius was the first person to say this. And isn't it true in medicine, if we don't learn the lessons of the past, we are bound to have to repeat them? And that's true whether we're talking about medicine or politics in the United States of America, for example. Second saying that Winnie was fond of saying was that it's better to be lucky than good. And one of my all-time favorites was that good judgment comes from experience, but unfortunately, experience comes from bad judgment. Isn't that the truth? So a beautiful paper that was written by one of my dear friends, Stephen Filowski. He's a neurosurgeon. He's very, very much engaged in some of the up-and-coming research on neuromodulation. And he and his associates talked about anticipating and preventing complications in spinal cord stimulator implantation. It was published last year as an expert review of medical devices. Please just take a moment. These are the kinds of things that you should read if you're currently engaged in the process of placing implantable devices, whether we're talking about stims or pumps. I'm only going to talk a little bit about literature. There's another two or three papers I want to mention. Here's another one from my good friend Salim Hayek at the Case Western Reserve University in Cleveland. And I included it because it's fairly comprehensive. It covers 8 years of experience from a very experienced clinician and implanter, that's Dr. Hayek and his associates, talking about treatment-limiting complications of percutaneous spinal cord stimulator implants. And he talked about the fact that there's 34.6% complications when we implant spinal cord stimulators in our patients. Now that sounds like a huge number, 34.6. One out of three individuals or more is going to sustain one or more types of complications with an implantable device. And I'm going to show you data from him, as well as across the street at the Cleveland Clinic from Nagy McCall as well. Here's a nice paper because it's recent and it's also a systematic review and a meta-analysis. It comes from Blackburn and Associates. They looked at 32 articles to conduct this systematic review and the meta-analysis. They found an overall 21.1 complication rate. So whether you look at a single center like Hayek's place at the Case Western Reserve with 34.6 or this large series of studies, 32, we know that somewhere between 1 in 5 and 1 in 3 patients is going to sustain a complication when we use neuromodulation implantable devices. Now, what types of complications are we talking about? And where do these complications result from? Sometimes it's physician error in judgment. In fact, that's the number one reason that physicians get sued for complications with neuromodulation and intrathecal drug delivery systems, is that you made an error in judgment. And I'll show you that data too, from some closed claim stuff which was published in the journal Pain Physician recently. Equipment issues constitute, in this review, 12% of the complications. There are technical factors, much lesser, and medical conditions related to the patient's underlying condition. You've heard some of those discussions earlier today. So, hardware related, what are we talking about? Well, in Hayek's publication of 34.6% complications, 74% or three-fourths of those complications, three-fourths of the 34% were due to lead migration or lead fracture failure. We can't control those things in many cases, right? A lot of times a patient twists in bed while sleeping and they come back a few days later, they say the stimulation pattern has changed, they're no longer deriving analgesia, and lo and behold, you put them under your x-ray fluoroscope and you see that the lead is fractured or that the lead has moved. I've had leads that have moved cephalad, I've had leads that have moved caudad. And there's not really, even with great anchoring and great patient selection, there's really no way to always determine and predict who will have a lead migration. Then the biological related types of complications from Filowski, Provenzano, and a nice paper in 2019, which I'll reference. Infection rates, again, holding steady at 3.11%. And I am humbled by this statistic because if you look at, for example, and this was mentioned by Dr. Capriol, I believe, at the last session, that joint replacement surgery has improved. The national incidence of joint replacement surgery related complications of an infectious nature is all the way down to about 2%. So we're not doing as well as our orthopedic surgery colleagues in that regard. Pain over the implant, this is considered biologically related. Post-thorough puncture headache, again, if you want a good paper on that, it's myself and Rom Stevens, published a few years back with about 190 references. And then neurological injury, and we won't spend much time on that. Well, obviously, we're mostly concerned with first do no harm. We first don't want to harm our patients, but then there's the real world consequence of what happens if there's a complication. It can lead to a medical negligence suit. You heard yesterday at the lunchtime segment, in this country, people can and will sue for every contingency. Just merely being uncomfortable, merely having something go not perfectly wrong or having a miscommunication can lead to the generation of a lawsuit. This is a nice paper by Dr. Kamath and Associates, published a few years back in Pain Physician, a descriptive analysis of federal and state interventional pain malpractice litigation in the U.S. And it's a pilot investigation. They looked at 30 years worth of data, so from 1988 to 2018 worth of data. And this is what they found. Now, the good news is that in a slight majority of cases, 57% of cases, we were victorious. We, meaning the defendants. What do you call an anesthesiologist who's wearing a business suit? A defendant. You know, that's basically it. So in 57.3% of cases, we were victorious versus about 41.5% favoring the plaintiff. What I found to be interesting from this large review of Kamath and Associates was that procedures that were conducted in the operating room led to greater plaintiff awards. So I would have thought that that would be superior, that the operating room was a safe haven compared to an ambulatory surgery center, but I was totally wrong. This data would speak otherwise. When comparing cases that were performed in the OR to outside the OR, in 83.3% of time, the plaintiff was found to have an award, and the judgment was found in favor of the plaintiff. So I think the expectations of juries is that if you're doing something in the OR, bad things should not happen. I don't know why. I don't know if that's just an assumption on my part, but it seems that the awards from the OR go more often to the plaintiff patient injured. The median award was about $250,000, so that's not terrible. Most of us have malpractice insurance of $1 million, $3 million. Some of us have multiple double and triple layers. However, the highest award was $36 million. Just imagine that you're practicing and somebody's been paralyzed, God forbid, or been killed from your device, or has been rendered totally impaired, $36 million for spinal cord stimulator bad outcome. The median payment, of course, as I stated, in the operating room was higher than it was in an ambulatory surgery center, about $450,000. And again, what did people get sued for? Errors in judgment. Procedural error was the leading reason for pursuing litigation. So you made a mistake, or even if you didn't, some so-called expert witness got up and stated under oath that they found that your technique was faulty. And there are, obviously, there's a huge marketplace for individuals who will so testify against you, regardless whether you thought you were following every single protocol from A to Z. So if you look at, again, the types of things that lead to lawsuit, and this paper wasn't exclusive to neuromodulation, epidural injections, in the majority of cases, two-thirds, the physician was victorious. Only one-third percentage of the cases, 33%, was the patient victorious. But for spinal cord stimulators, it looks like in 60% of cases, according to this review, the patient was victorious versus the physician being exonerated in 40% of cases. Look at intrathecal pumps, which I'm not talking about today. In 100% of the cases, according to this review of Kamath, the patient was given a jury award based on physician negligence. So, food for thought. So what are the preventable case scenarios? Dural puncture headache, we're not going to talk about. We're using large needles, typically 14 gauge needles, 4.5 inch needles, 5 inch needles, 6 inch needles. If you puncture the dura during the performance of spinal cord stimulator placement, there's a significant likelihood that that patient's going to have a dural puncture headache. It has to do with how you manage it. Do you do an autologous epidural blood patch? Just by a show of hands, you're doing a spinal cord stimulator trial or implant, you get a wet tap, the patient's under 40 years old, and they develop a headache. You try conservative measures, you try caffeine, abdominal bracing, all the usual things, recumbency. How many people in the audience would do an autologous epidural blood patch on top of a fresh implant? How many would do it? Okay, about four or five. How many people would not do it? Dr. Singh says no way to an autologous. Is that because of infectious risks you're concerned about, or because of causing some type of scarring in the, near where the implant is placed?
I believe that the lead provides some form of TAM to that.
So Dr. Singh believes that the lead itself could potentially lead to closing off the dural rent. I have performed autologous epidural blood patches on three or four occasions. They've been very effective. But I see that there's two potential schools of thought, just letting the patient kind of ride it out. But I've had a person with a persistent headache that lasted for 2 months, and I finally bit the bullet, and I did an autologous epidural blood patch without any sequela. Worsening of pain, failure to derive appropriate stimulation, these are all potential sources of litigation and bad patient outcomes and technical failure. The worst case scenarios, which we're going to talk primarily about infectious risks. I don't want to spend a significant time about paralysis and death. They are sentinel events when they occur. They do occur. If you look at the closed claims data, I live in this and practice in the state of Illinois. We have something called the Illinois Jury Verdict Reporter, and it's available to attorneys. I have attorney friends who share that information with me. It gives a laundry list of all the cases that have occurred in the past several months in the state, so I periodically review it. You see some horrendous things that have occurred both in anesthesiology as well as interventional pain, and there are cases of paralysis, there are cases of death, not just with neuromodulation. I've seen a handful of cases of transforaminal paralysis cases when particulate steroids were utilized or sharp needles were utilized primarily, and that's not the subject of this discussion. There's also been two or three deaths that I've seen in Illinois from spinal cord stimulation. So let's talk about infections. According to the Center for Disease Control here in Atlanta, Georgia, surgical site infections are classified as three types: superficial, incisional, deep incisional, or organ or space infection. Now, gratefully, we're talking about spinal cord stimulation. Unless you get an epidural abscess or some type of disc seeding of bacteria or some type of vertebral osteoplastic type of procedure, you're not going to see too many deep space infections. They do occur, obviously, and they demand urgent neurosurgical intervention. What we see primarily with neuromodulation and intrathecal drug delivery systems are things like seroma formation, and that's hearkened by redness, pain, heat, or swelling, or in Spanish or Latin, we see rubor, dolor, calor, and tumor at the site of the incision, or sometimes with drainage or leakage of pus out of the incisional site. Then there's deep incisional infections that affect the fascial and the muscle layers. That can be heralded by the indication of pus or an abscess. Sometimes, rarely, not always, a patient will have a fever. Typically, they'll have tenderness about the wound, or there'll be separation of the edges of the incision, which expose the deeper tissues. As I talked about organ or deep space infections, in this case, because we're talking about an implantable spinal device, we're talking primarily about epidural abscess or a spinal meningitis type of situation. So here's a superficial surgical site infection. You can see that the wound is leaking a little bit. How many people in the audience, when confronted with a seroma, would aspirate the seroma? How many? How many would not aspirate the seroma? Okay, so it's about mixed. I aspirate every seroma, every single seroma, and I send what I aspirate from the wound for culture and sensitivity, and I start the patient empirically on antibiotics if they were not previously on antibiotics. That's my own policy. I don't have any hard data to support that practice, but I have found when doing so, first of all, when I aspirate the seroma, I remove the nidus for infection, whatever it is that's causing this patient to develop an ongoing exudate. I try to remove that. I also want to know, is it bacterial contaminated? Is it not bacterial contaminated? And I'll show you some instances of that in the next slide. Deep surgical site infections are those which involve deeper myofascial layer or the organ space infection. So these are two patients I had in the last 12 months. On the left side, you see a serosanguinous fluid that I removed from a seroma from an implantable pulse generator, 57 mLs. Now, this wasn't the only time the patient had a seroma. They came back every week for 4 weeks, and I aspirated until I could aspirate no longer. And I did it using a full surgical sterile approach, sterile gloves, mask, gown, everything else. And I sent it for culture and sensitivity, came back totally aseptic, nothing there. On the right-hand side, you see a different patient with 36 or 35 cc's of fluid, not serosanguine. It's the same thing, no bacteria. It looks a little bit cloudy. It looks kind of like urine. These are the kinds of things you see with a seroma, but I always aspirate them. I always, first of all, for patient comfort, a seroma is painful. Many times they're wearing an abdominal binder, they're wearing their pants, they're wearing a belt, and they find that they can't even lean backwards or sit backwards. There's almost instantaneous relief in my experience when I've aspirated these seromas. Of course, deep infections are the bane of our existence when they occur, either an epidural abscess or vertebral osteomyelitis. I've never seen it, gratefully, in my own practice, but I've seen cases of it. I've treated patients who've had these types of infectious processes following intervention. One of the strangest cases that I ever had was a professor of neurosurgery at the University of Chicago sent me a patient. This is not related to spinal cord stimulation. Sent me a patient a month after he had done a laminectomy on her. She was a 34-year-old Caucasian woman, came into my office in a wheelchair, and the neurosurgeon called my office because he had just seen her and said, "I want you to see this person. She's drug-seeking. She's manipulative." I said, "Sure, I'll be happy to see her." She came into the office. She was in a wheelchair. She had an assistant with her, and she was wearing a white t-shirt. It was in August, and I said, "What's the problem?" She goes, "Oh, my legs are tingling and heavy." She's going, "I'm having trouble controlling my urinary function." I said, "You're looking for narcotics?" She goes, "No, sir, I don't want any drugs. I just want to feel better." So I began to examine her. I lifted up her shirt. She had a softball-sized mass right over the surgical incision that gratefully had a sinus which was draining copious amounts of pus. And I said, "Well, you just saw Dr. K down in his office 10 minutes ago." I said, "Did he palpate this?" She said, "No, he never examined my back." So what turned out to be a big nothing burger for the neurosurgeon turned out to be an 18-centimeter banded epidural abscess. And I called him, and he was not happy about my findings. The simple fact that I had conducted a comprehensive evaluation and found this massive epidural abscess, which he then had to go back in the same day and aspirate and put her on intravenous at-home antibiotics for 6 months. And so it's obviously physical examination is extremely important to rule out some of these catastrophic things that can occur. So what are the types of things that increase the risk of infection? Well, endogenous contamination. We're not typically doing cases near the bowel, per se, although I've seen people who have implanted intrathecal drug delivery systems who've perforated the bowel. A couple of cases that have come to my attention from a medical legal standpoint, but that will increase the risk of an endogenous contamination. We're primarily concerned with exogenous contamination. When we cleanse the skin, we have choices available to us. We have alcohol, we have chlorhexidine, we have betadine. Show of hands in the audience, those who perform implantable devices, how many people are using betadine? So a couple. How many people are using chlorhexidine? And how many people are using chlorhexidine plus alcohol? In fact, the CDC has strongly recommended, and I'll show you the data on that, to use chlorhexidine plus alcohol to minimize the possible contamination exogenously to our patients. There are also factors which could diminish the efficacy of the general immune response. For example, our patients, and you heard discussions about this today, who have diabetes, who are malnourished, who have immunosuppressive therapy. And you know, I kind of hesitate to talk about immunosuppression because I was involved in the largest series of HIV positive patients in the country. We published data about 10 years ago. We had 16 patients who had HIV. Some of them had had full-blown AIDS, but they were in remission. We implanted spinal cord stimulators in those patients for neuropathic pain in the lower extremities, not a single infectious case. So that's a small sample that doesn't prove that immunosuppression is not a risk factor for ultimately having an infection. However, the data was fairly robust, very reassuring that even with immunosuppression, sometimes you can go forth with neuromodulation devices. The use of steroids, radiotherapy, one thing that I would point out that a lot of times we have our patients, we perform lumbar or cervical or thoracic epidural steroid injections, patients don't get better, and then we go ahead and perform an implantable device, a spinal cord stimulator, for example. Well, if you talk to the orthopedic surgeons, they won't touch a patient who's had steroids within 90 days of their procedure. The orthopods will not touch a patient. I had a patient who had a horrible shoulder. I did a subacromial injection on him in January. The surgeon wouldn't touch him until this past April, just last week, because he said you had steroids and the risk of infection, even though the data is kind of not that robust on this topic, they will not operate on your patients if they've had steroid injections. A lot of us in the audience maybe don't remember that. We do our epidural injection, the patient's scheduled for their stimulator 2 weeks or 4 weeks from now, and we go forward and do the device. We should probably consider that again in the future. Local immune responses, foreign bodies, damaged tissues, and if the patient has a hematoma. Now, the National Nosocomial Infection Surveillance, NNIS system, assigns risks, and so it's important to understand that our patients, many of them are in our elderly population. The percentage of individuals above the age of 60, 70, or 80 is ever increasing. A patient with an ASA preoperative assessment score of 3 or greater is at a higher risk for having an infection following one of these types of procedures. An operation classified as contaminated or dirty, most of the cases that we do are not with that classification. And an operation lasting over T hours. So just to be honest, how many people in the room take greater than 60 minutes for a permanent implant of a spinal cord stimulator, skin to skin? I'm talking about from the time you infiltrate the local anesthetic in the skin to the time that the last a monocryl or a dermabond or anything goes in. How many people are taking more than 60 minutes? How many people are taking more than 90 minutes? So it's an important thing. You know, I worked in teaching institutions for the vast majority of my professional career. We had residents, we had fellows working with us, and it wasn't that atypical for a stimulator to take more than 60 minutes. Now I keep my operating times to about 45 minutes to the extent that I'm capable of doing that. There is data to suggest that beyond 60 and certainly beyond 90 minutes, you increase exponentially the risk of infection for your patients. So these are the 8 factors that can possibly contribute to surgical site infections. Their independent risk factors are age above 75, ASA classification greater than 3, malnutrition, low serum albumin radiotherapy, chronic or even acute steroid use, but certainly chronic steroid use, for example, with asthmatics. Now, obesity and smoking are 2 factors which Dr. Provenzano, Dr. Filowski consider to be independent risk factors, but I'm not so sure. And the reason I say that is going back 10 years or so ago, myself, Dr. Nick Nezovich, who's a research animal, looked at these data. We actually presented this data at the American Society of Regional Anesthesia meeting in 2013. I'll show you that in just a moment. But I want to take them each alone and in tandem, obesity and smoking. So we'll talk about smoking and we'll talk about obesity. Are they risk factors for infections related to spinal cord stimulator use? So the reason I include my original poster on this is because we were subjected to academic misconduct. And when I say that, we presented this data at the ASHRA meeting in 2013. This is our first 64 patients that we completed permanent stims in 1 year. We were getting ready to prepare for publication, and Nick, my researcher, said, hey, let's get 200 patients because for statistical reasons, that'll make greater sense, it'll have a greater impact. So we waited an extra year. In the process of collecting more data, somebody who had been at the ASHRA meeting, who had heard our presentation, went ahead and published their results from a large academic institution in Ohio. So those of you who are in academics should take heed about what I'm telling you. Present data, and if it's strong data, and if people love the data, somebody may go out and usurp that or go forth and try to put forward their own spin on what they found. And so I'm still a little bit salty about that. As you can see, it's 10 years and I haven't gotten over it yet. That's the New York part of me that haven't forgotten. So smoking, individuals who were smokers, this is 64 patients. We put in spinal cord stimulators for failed back surgery syndrome was 53% of the patients. CRPS was 19%, and patients with low back pain was 21%. So we were doing low back pain stims way before it became fashionable to do that or even published data. So smoking was not associated as a risk factor for failure of analgesia. We found that to be fascinating. Obesity was not a risk factor for failure of analgesia. You can see on the first set of data is the smoking data, those who had pain before the implant versus pain after the implant, and were about the same as those who were non-smoking. Smokers and non-smokers both got better. We categorized patients into 3 categories based on body mass index, below 25, between 25 and 30, and above 30. And so obesity or large, high body mass index was not an independent risk factor for failure of analgesia. Also, we then segregated the data to look at things like infection rates, migration of leads, revision incidence and reprogramming. And with obesity, we found, interestingly, in these 64 patients, that obesity was not an independent risk factor for infection. It was not an independent risk factor for migration of leads, for revision requirements, or for reprogramming. The only thing that we found from this first 64 patients from our ultimate destination of 200 patients was that lead migration and the need for revision was higher in smokers. Now you might ask why. We don't know. Are smokers more prone to coughing? And is coughing an increase in intra-abdominal pressure habitually lead to somehow causing them to have their leads move a little bit and ultimately need to be revised? We don't know. It's all theoretical and hypothetical. We don't know. But that were the only findings of significance from these studies. We went on to publish them a few years later, but we didn't have the luxury of publishing them in a higher impact factor journal by virtue of the academic shenanigans that occurred in Ohio. Surgical site infections are important because they lead to readmission rates for our patients. Remember, readmission is one of the red flags that all insurance companies are looking for. Patients who are readmitted with an infection are twice as likely to die. Just getting readmitted, just a simple fact of coming into the hospital is associated with at least a $3,000 over expenditure that was not included when you had your patient approved for the neuromodulation implant. And of course, rates have not fallen. This is really the humbling statistic. We're still hovering, despite our best efforts, at about a 3% infection rate. Here's a nice paper from Tim Deere. If you look at the authors associated with this, it's like a who's who of neuromodulation. You've got Nagy, Tim Deere, Jason Pope, Elliot Krames, Jose de Andres from Spain. I just was back with him in Barcelona last week conducting his interventional pain workshop for the Fundalor group. If anyone has an interest in coming down in April, every April, Dr. De Andres from Barcelona has a tremendous course, a cadaver course over 3 days at the University of Barcelona. Sam Aldave is in there, Gladstone McDowell, Paul Lynch, Leo Capriole. Just look at Bob Levy, Sam LaRouse, and so forth. So they looked at that the thing that they found which led to a lower rate of infectious complications with neuromodulation was experience. Now that would seem intuitive and inferential. The more cases you've done, the less likely you would expect that you would have an infection. 30 to 40% of the complications of an infectious nature do lead to revision. As I said, if it's a seroma, you could aspirate it. There's no evidence in favor of or in favor against aspirating the seroma. I do that as a matter of principle. I think patient comfort also, taking away a potential nidus for infection is a good medical practice. Evidence-based therapies, the experience of the implanter, the time it takes to perform the implant, and their cutoff in this review was 90 minutes. They said if you're going beyond 90 minutes, you need to have either retraining or reconsider your technical approach to neuromodulation and education, of course. Now this is the data, and you heard Leo at the last session talking a little bit about infectious complications. If you look at the orthopedic data over several years, the incidence of infectious complications from total knee or total hip arthroplasty hovers at about 2%. But our orthopedic colleagues are very vigorous about prepping patients, are very vigorous about avoiding patients who've had recent exposure to steroids, whether it's systemic steroids or just topical steroids or steroids injected into a joint space. They will not touch those patients for 90 days. Look at the ventricular assist device. That's really the highest incidence of infectious complications, hovering at about 40%. And there's a large amount of those that are done each year. And the cost of combined medical and surgical treatment to treat the infections, about $50,000. So mechanical heart valve, 4%, vascular graft, 4%, plastic surgeries, mammary implant, 2%. You can see that we're right at about inflatable penile implants, 3%. So that's where we are with our implantable devices. Systematic reviews, despite all our best efforts, continue to show about a 3 to 4.5% incidence of an infectious complication for implanted pain devices, and by that I mean stims and pumps. The process study showed an 8% infectious rate, and for other implant specialties, as I stated, it's 2 to 6%. So what's the impact of an infection on our patients? Well, the best case scenario is that the patient will be on prolonged oral antibiotics. How many people are giving their patients routinely after an implant antibiotics to take for 7 to 10 days going home? How many are not treating them besides the intraoperative antibiotics? So the worst case scenario, of course, I do treat my patients. I treat them both 15 to 30 minutes prior to skin incision. Of course, I give intravenous antibiotics on a weight-based ratio. I typically use either cefazolin or clindamycin or sometimes vancomycin depending on the circumstances. And then I typically give my patients clindamycin 300 milligrams every 8 hours for 10 days after all of these implantable procedures. I also do that for my trials, by the way, and there's no evidence to support that practice. So I want to emphasize that, but that's my own unique practice. The worst case scenario is that the patient requires a major surgery and they lose the system. And of course, medical costs may double when patients have a surgical site infection. Here's a nice paper from my friend, Nagy McHale, from the Cleveland Clinic, looking at several years worth of data, 707 cases of spinal stimulation, indications and complications. And they found that there were a couple of superficial infections that required and responded to oral antibiotics in all cases, but there were some deep spinal infections that required home intravenous antibiotic therapy for up to 6 weeks following the infection. What they found was that infections were more probable to follow implantation of a stimulator device in cases of failed back surgery syndrome compared to CRPS, and that is kind of intuitive and inferential. Patients who've had extensive scarring, perhaps in the epidural space, could potentially be more prone to an infectious process. That's just speculative. I don't have any basis or foundation to support that. I'm just trying to understand why failed back or persistent spinal surgical pain might lead to a higher rate of infectious complications compared to CRPS. And neuropathy also was higher than CRPS. Here's a good paper by Jan Ruttiger a few years ago in neuromodulation, who also found that the infection rate was between 2.5 to 13% following implantation of spinal cord stimulation. A nice paper by Mitch Engel, published about 10 years ago in Pain Physician, infectious complications related to either intrathecal drug delivery systems or spinal cord stimulators. You can see that the nice thing about this paper was that they tried to categorize patients on infectious risk according to their NNIS risk level. So if the risk level was low, then the infectious complications were very low. If the risk level was 1, then there was a higher likelihood of infection, and of course, that went up exponentially as the risk factor, the National Nosocomial Infection Surveillance System, and we talked about those factors earlier on in this lecture. The higher that the NNIS risk level was, the greater the incidence was for an infection. So how do we prevent an infection in our implantables, whether we're talking drug delivery systems or spinal cord stimulators? There are certain things we can do preoperatively, intraoperatively, and postoperatively. Nice paper by Provenzano and Deer about the recommendations for reducing infection in the practice of implanting stimulators and drug delivery devices. This is called a physician's playbook, a nice primer, if you will, on how to try to manage and prevent infections. And so they talked about using weight-based dosing antibiotics. Don't just give 1 gram of cefazolin to all your patients, whether their BMI, whether their weight is 70 kilos or 270 kilos. Make sure that you weight-base that. Depilation of the hair, this should be done immediately prior to the implant procedure. So the night before is not good practice. If you have patients who have hairy backs, or the area of the abdomen where you're going to be implanting either the IPG or the reservoir for your intrathecal drug delivery system, hair removal should occur in the immediacy with the patient on the operating room table. Appropriate agent selection for skin antisepsis, as I told you, there's hard evidence from the Center for Disease Control that chlorhexidine in alcohol is superior to not only chlorhexidine alone, but also to povidone iodine. So this is something food for thought if you're still using betadine. Not that I haven't done it in my practice, but I have probably haven't done it in 20 years. Probably should give some reconsideration to what you're doing for preemptively for cleaning the patient's skin before their implantable device. Identifying patient risk factors, again, very important. Often overlooked that we give injections of steroids to these patients within a 3-month period before they come in for a device. Maybe we should reconsider that. Again, that's speculative. We don't have strong data. I'm merely basing that assumption or that statement on what our orthopedic colleagues do before they'll consider joint replacement in any patient of the upper or lower extremities. They will not touch those patients for a minimum of 90 days. And I haven't seen any such recommendations by any of the major interventional societies. Optimizing comorbidities, such as diabetes. We've heard some discussions earlier today about what the optimal hemoglobin A1C is probably before offering our patients implantables. I don't know what that number is. I continue to monitor those patients, but I don't have a strong and fast cutoff. So preoperative prevention, electrical hair clipping when necessary. Only 76% of us who do these procedures are actually doing that. And very fewer patients are receiving hair depilation in the immediacy before the implant. Screen and treat MRSA carriers. Only about half of us are ever screening. Not even 11 to 25% of us are even screening with nasal swabs our patients for MRSA before we subject them to implantable devices. And then 56 to 86% of us, according to big surveys, are treating those patients. Antibiotic selection, only up to 96% of us are even using preoperative antibiotics. And weight-based is even less, it's less than 50%. Chlorhexidine-based skin prep with alcohol, again, I'm gonna reemphasize that because there is CDC 1B evidence in favor of chlorhexidine plus alcohol, very important. Antimicrobial draping is important. A lot of us use these betadine drapes. How many people put some type of drape impregnated with betadine on the patient's skin immediately before cutting the skin? Double gloving, how many of us double glove before we touch these patients? That's another, it's only found in about 50% of us who do that. Laminar flow hood, HEPA filters, I don't have that in my OR or my surgical center, but that's been suggested. Limiting traffic, right? You have these scenarios where 14 people come in the OR to ask you questions, or the nurse practitioner has a patient who doesn't want to wait, or somebody has to come in. One of my orthopedic surgeons, where I formerly was a chair of anesthesia, used to lock the door in the OR. Once everybody was in, you couldn't leave. It didn't matter whether the case was 2 hours or 15 hours. You had to stay in that OR. You couldn't go to the bathroom, couldn't have a lunch break, because he wanted to reduce his infectious rate from 4.2%, and he did. He got it down to 2%, which was the national average. Wound irrigation, how many people of us are copiously irrigating our wounds with either bacitracin or vancomycin and saline? This is a kind of an important concept. Careful closure, sometimes antibiotic powders or Tyrex pouches are useful. This is, shows you a CDC, the Center for Disease Control here in Atlanta, Georgia. It's a 1B recommendation to use chlorhexidine and alcohol based upon studies, because the infectious risk with that combination is less than with povidone iodine, substantially less, and it's also less than by either alcohol alone or chlorhexidine alone. I know some people who prep the skin with all three, alcohol, chlorhexidine, betadine. I actually do a double prep with chlorhexidine iodine. I prep, I wait 3 minutes, I prep again, then I wait 3 minutes before I actually touch or even drape the patient. In fact, in one of the hospitals where I work, they wouldn't, the nurses actually have a stop clock and they wouldn't allow you to even drape the patient until 4 minutes have elapsed from the time you apply your antiseptic. Weight-based dosing, cefazolin, 1 gram for less than 80 kilos, 2 grams for 80 to 160, 3 grams above 160. Important, it's not an insignificant consequence to use weight-based dosing. Bioocclusive dressing, I use a lot of Dermabond. How many people use some type of Dermabond on their skin when they're finished? I like it because it's impermeable to water. It helps the patient to be able to shower on the same day or the day after they have their implantable device. Patients like it, I like it. So far to date, I haven't seen infectious complications using Dermabond for my patients. Continue to manage the patient. Wound surveillance, very important. Few of us are doing that. I have the patients come back within 3 days of an implant, no matter what it was, within the first week again for a second time, and then at every week for the first 4 weeks to assess that wound. If I find a seroma, I aspirate the seroma. I send that fluid down for culture and sensitivity, and I treat the patient empirically with antibiotics. And again, postoperative antibiotics, only about half of us are really doing that reliably. Nice paper from Dave Provenzano, the president of the American Society of Regional Anesthesia, and some of my colleagues, another big name paper, Tim Deers there, Salim Hayek, one of my former fellows, Monak Rana, who I also worked with extensively for 12 years, Dr. Bhuvanendran, the interim director of anesthesia at Rush. An international survey to understand infection control practices related to spinal cord stimulation. The participants of this survey, where the majority of them came from the United States, and more likely than not, they were in private practice with lesser participants from academia, but 60% were doing less than 20 implants per year. I do 40 to 50 implants per year. How many people do more than 50 implants per year? Wow, that's great. How many do more than 100 implants per year? Anybody?
My record was 127 at that. Oh, that goes back about 10 years, but I've cut back dramatically.
But 90 minutes of surgical time, less than 80% were there. But that means that 20% of respondents to this survey were taking more than an hour and a half to place a permanent implant, the IPG plus the lead. That's really probably too long, and certainly potentially could lead to greater exposure exogenously of our patients. Too much manipulation of the tissues, too much opportunity for bacteria to creep in from those open wounds to get in and potentially lead to an infectious process. Now, 97% of individuals who responded to this survey were giving antibiotic prophylaxis within 1 hour prior to skin incision. I think 1 hour is too long. Typically 15 to 30 minutes is the optimal time with which to administer your intravenous antibiotic prophylaxis. The stunning thing to me was that a full 3% of respondents were not using antibiotic prophylaxis prior to their implant. Use of skin depilation. This is a 1A recommendation from the Center for Disease Control here in Atlanta, Georgia, is to be done immediately before the procedure. So the night before doesn't make any sense. Telling the patient to go home and have their wife shave their back 2 days before the procedure, none of that makes any sense. It should be done by you or your surgical assistant in the immediacy before the implant. And that's probably the most important thing. Using a clipper, not a shaver, a clipper tends to be less traumatic to the skin. What to use to clean the skin? Again, the CDC 1B recommendation, pretty strong evidence in favor of chlorhexidine plus alcohol. That doesn't mean you're committing malpractice if you use something else like chlorhexidine alone or povidone iodine. But I think that if you sustain an infectious complication that leads to an adverse outcome for your patient and a claim of medical negligence where you are the defendant, practitioner, somebody may take you to task because this is a fairly strong recommendation. Trial spinal cord stimulator. How long do you use antibiotics for? Well, 10% used only 1 day, the day that it was given in the operating room. 70%, that's more than 2/3 of us who are doing these, use antibiotics for the duration of the trial. I do. I dose my patients for up to 7 to 10 days. Even if I remove the trial's leads at 5 or 6 days, I continue the antibiotic prophylaxis for a full 10 days of my patients. How long do you use antibiotics after permanent, according to the survey? Again, 1/3 of us who do these were using antibiotics after the implant for a full week, up to a full week, but some of us were not using it even for more than 24 hours. Almost 1 out of 5 implanters or interventionalists were not giving antibiotics beyond the immediacy of surgery. So what do you do if you have an infection? Assess the situation. You need to get a C-reactive protein and erythrocyte sedimentation rate. I ignore white blood cell counts because they're basically useless in the face of a potential infection. But certainly, we have high sensitivity, if not specificity, for erythrocyte sedimentation rate and C-reactive protein. Again, they're not specific for infection. They could just represent significant inflammation. So remember that a SED rate, especially in elderly individuals, can be abnormally elevated beyond 30 or 40 seconds. That doesn't mean that there's an infection, low specificity. But if you have a high SED rate in light of or in conjunction with a high C-reactive protein, that ought to trigger some type of action on your behalf. And of course, fevers in chills are not the most common presentation. The most common presentation is a worsening of pain, primarily at the surgical site, but also sometimes extending beyond the surgical site to the upper or lower parts of the back, to the lower extremities. And that whole redness, warmth, swelling, pain, rubor, calor, tumor, dolor, incisional drainage. Well, that's an obvious that you should not miss. Not like that neurological surgeon who sent that 34-year-old patient to me with a softball-sized mass leaking from her shirt. I mean, it should have been obvious from across the room if he had just examined her. He would have seen the fact that she was harboring a terrible 18-centimeter banded epidural abscess that he was responsible for having caused. Remember that an infection, according to infectious disease people, can be very late. It can take up to 3 months to manifest. So if the patient comes back at 90 days and they're complaining of increasing pain, warmth, redness, all the telltale signs, don't wash your hands and say, well, you must have banged your back or this is not related to my implant. There's a lot of data that suggests that an infection can be harbored for up to 3 months at the minimum. And that, I'm talking about deep wound infections, epidural abscesses, osteomyelitis. Obviously, I don't look at white blood cell counts. I don't find them to be useful, but certainly the CRP and SED rate are very important. Death and interventional pain management, I don't want to We're not going to take time and talk about that. They're rare events, usually preventable, disproportionately expensive. That $36 million case I cited earlier from the literature was actually a case that started out as a paraplegia, quadriplegia, and ended up as a death. And that was the ultimate disposition of that case. They're disproportionately expensive, and they're culled from the Illinois jury verdict reporter I told you about, the closed claims. I read that voraciously, like some people read the Sunday paper. So what are my summary and conclusions? Proper planning prevents poor performance. I kept that other P word out of there because we're in a public setting here. Number one is to determine if the patient needs a spinal cord stimulator, if you've exhausted other competing and alternative strategies for managing their low back pain, for their managing their diabetic peripheral neuropathy, for managing their radiculopathy, for managing their CRPS type 1 or type 2. Avoid super high-risk patients unless the risk-benefit ratio remains in favor of using neuromodulation. Avoid sharp needles for loss of resistance. We're all using fairly blunt 2E type needles, something with a blunt curve. Don't twist the needle in the epidural space. Phil Bromage used to always lecture me personally about that. A lot of folks will come in and they'll try to rotate that 2E needle in the epidural space. That's a setup for tearing the dura and leading to other consequences and complications. And Phil would always say, do not twist a 2E needle in the epidural space. Avoid deep sedation. I use copious amounts of local anesthetic. I use Exparel after my permanent implants. Anyone use Exparel? To provide up to 3 days of analgesia at the surgical site. Sending a patient home, it's expensive, it's costly. A lot of your surgical centers don't have Exparel. I personally have found it to be a great adjunct to limit patients' exposures to other types of analgesics. You put this extended duration bupivacaine in the wound before starting, and you can get full 24, 36, sometimes 50, 60, 70 hours of no pain or minimal pain at the incisional site. Go slow, go easy, tread softly, but keep your operating times down below 90 minutes. Try to get them below 60 minutes. Again, proper planning prevents poor performance. The number one key to success is always patient selection. And we don't always have the luxury of finding 25-year-old virgin backs with BMIs of 23.5. We don't always have that. A lot of times we're operating on sicker and larger individuals and smokers and diabetics. Use antibiotic by weight, hair depilation in the immediacy using clippers before the procedure. Brief op times. Again, I can't emphasize this enough. The longer you dilly-dally, the more you manipulate the tissues. We know statistically that's likely to lead to a higher potential risk of infection. I use an occlusive dressing at the termination of the procedure. If for some reason I haven't placed Dermabond on the skin, I will keep an occlusive dressing on for 7 to 10 days. Culture any suspicious wound. Get early sed rate. Track the sed rate, track the C-reactive protein, do serial studies on your patients. They're not expensive examinations, and I think that from a medical legal perspective, it goes a long way to keeping your patient safe and ultimately to keeping you safe. Thank you for your time and attention to this matter. Go out and throw a football now. There's a beautiful basketball court right out on the premises, and I challenge anyone here to a contest for football throwing at the completion. Thank you very much. Any questions? Any questions? Other questions that I can take? Dr. Singh, yes.
Thanks, Dr. Candido. Appreciate that. We were actually having a quick conversation about, you know, OR times. Could you comment on placing the leads with the needles first without cutting down, or cut down first? And
sure.
You know, would that change, for example, like a dorsal column placement versus a DRG placement?
Well, obviously that's a great question. Do you do the cut down before? I do not do a cut down before because many times I've had to change my approach. So if I say, for example, I'm entering an L1, L2, and I'm convinced that that's the appropriate target, I'm using my posterior anterior fluoroscopy to outline that space, and it looks great. I'm using magnification times 1 or 2 to really, and I use magnification, by the way, on almost all my implantables, because regardless of how much experience you have, it really changes the scope, and I know it's greater radiation exposure, but I always tell the x-ray tech, put it on MAG-1, but for brief periods of time. But I may select L1, L2. If I were to do a cut down there because I'm convinced I can get in, and then if for whatever reason I can't get in, or that the leads keep deviating off into the lateral gutter because there's some obstruction, plica mediana dorsalis, previous scar tissue, patients had a previous blood patch and they have some type of obstruction to getting, I may have to go down above that level, T12, L1, or down to L1, L2 and try to bypass that tract. So I don't do cut downs until I get my needles in place. And there's there are two schools of thought, right? Make the cut down first, open up the space, place the needle, and then do the rest of your work. I'm sure that I want to make sure that my needles are in the appropriate interspace before I start to cut down. I leave them in, obviously, because they protect the lead. Once the leads are in place, I do not remove my needles. I keep them in until the very, very end. But and I understand folks who would like to do the cut down at the initiation of the procedure, but because I've had to modify my approach, I've been burned so many times, despite what I posit to be an acceptable anatomical target, I've been humbled too many times. So I refrain from doing that cut down preemptively. I wait until I'm sure that my leads are in the appropriate location. I can't tell you how many times I've had to modify that approach. The lead keeps deviating or keeps bending or keeps going anteriorly, right? How many times we see that it looks perfect and you start to, you're feeding that lead and it looks great, and then you go to your lateral and everyone sighs in the room like, oh damn, here we go again, and it's going anteriorly, it's going ventrally. The patient's even jumping a little bit because they're lightly sedated in my practice. So I wait until my leads are exactly where I want them to be. Then I do the cut down. And I would emphasize the use of this Exparel. I don't have any remuneration from the company. I have no interest whatsoever in it. But giving your patient analgesia for a prolonged period of time goes a long way. I never use lidocaine for my incisions. I always use, at the minimum, bupivacaine. At the minimum. I've seen too many other of my colleagues who use lidocaine for their cut downs and for their local infiltration, and 2 hours later the patient's in agonizing pain. They won't even go home, and they're getting fentanyl IV in the recovery room, and they're on intravenous acetaminophen in the recovery room. So that's my humble, and again, there's no data to substantiate what I'm saying. I use long-acting local anesthetics in each and every time, whether it's a trial or permanent implant. But to your point, I don't do my cut downs until I'm assured that my leads are in the appropriate anatomical location and the impedance levels are in an acceptable range. And if I'm waking up the patient to do a test, and I do that less often, by the way, now, I place my leads virtually exclusively anatomically, and I have found very low failure rate by doing that. The days of waking up a groggy patient face down on a table who's already received midazolam and some propofol, and you feel it, you feel it in the right leg, okay, it's a wrap, let's go. I don't buy into that. So I put them in anatomically. I know from having mapped the patient out previously where their pain generator is, and I try to target that pain generator, and I get the heck out of Dodge. Other questions, please? Well, you've been a wonderful audience. Thanks for inviting me, Dr. Gill. Thanks for having me.